In the 19th century, when the celebrated Scottish historian Thomas Carlyle tried to write a biography about the life of Oliver Cromwell, he made the following observation. He said, "Before I could proceed with my work, I first of all had to drag out the dead body of Oliver Cromwell from beneath a mountain of dead dogs." And what did he mean by this? Well, that's an interesting remark. Hundreds of years after the English Revolution, you see, my friends, we did have a revolution in this country, chopped the king's head off and did a number of other interesting things. But that was a long time ago. And despite the passage of time, the English ruling class always had a very vindictive and hostile attitude towards their own revolution, which of course they betrayed when they invited Charlie Boy back from France. Nevertheless, this is an interesting point because it's typical. You see, the ruling class is afraid of revolution. They fear revolution as the devil fears holy water. You see this not just in Britain, but you see it in France. I well remember when it was the anniversary of the French Revolution, the Great French Revolution, in the 1980s. There was an astonishing avalanche of books and articles and speeches showing not just a hatred of the French Revolution. They were supposed to be celebrating it. They were not celebrating it. There was an outpouring of all kinds of filth against the revolution, against the leaders. A very spiteful, vindictive, malicious, even personal attacks to blacken the character of people like Robespierre and particularly Marat, who I particularly admire. I think Marat was one of the great leaders of the French masses, of the French Revolution. But he's portrayed as a bloodthirsty monster, and all of the leaders of the French Revolution are portrayed in this way. Now, this tells us absolutely nothing about the real character of people like Robespierre, Marat, and others. But it tells us a great deal about the psychology of the ruling class and its profound hatred and fear, because there's fear at the basis of this, against revolution in general. And of course, this being the 100th anniversary of the October Revolution, you can expect a similar outpouring of hatred. I mean, the modern historians, the bourgeois historians of the Russian Revolution, they really are something. Not one of them is worth reading. I would go so far as to say that. I had a debate with Orlando Figgs, or Fidges, or whatever his damn name is. You can check it out on the internet. I was astonished at the extreme low level, even the abuse which this so-called academic gentleman resorted to. And this is typical. It's typical. I mean, you can't compare these people with E.H. Carr, for example, who was a decent man, former editor of the Times, who had attempted at least to put an objective account of the Bolshevik Revolution and of Lenin and the Bolsheviks. Not so now. There's an appalling chorus of vilification. It's an industry, and quite a profitable industry if it comes to that. You know, a few years ago, actually, I was approached by the History Channel to participate in a program on the French Revolution, and they rang me up from New York. A nice young man rang me up and asked me the following. He said, "Look, can I ask you a question before we start?" I said, "Yes, by all means." He said, "Can you justify the French Revolution?" I said, "Well, that's a very strange question. Why do you ask me that?" He said, "Well, you know, the killings and the bloodshed and the guillotine and so on and so forth." I said, "Well, look, you know the answer to that question better than I." He said, "Why do you say that?" I said, "Well, you're a Yank, aren't you? You're an American. And didn't you guys have a revolution in the 18th century? I seem to remember. And I believe you didn't treat the Brits very gently, did you?" I said, "And then what about the second American revolution?" He said, "What revolution is that?" I said, "Well, you know, the Civil War, Abraham Lincoln, the emancipation of the slaves." "Yes," I said, do you know that proportionate to the size of population, and this is a fact, by the way, in proportion to the size of population, many more people were killed in the American Civil War than they were killed in the Russian Civil War. No, he didn't know that. No, I said, no. But, and yet the strange thing is this, you know, I said to him, to this day, nobody's ever asked me whether the American Revolution was justified or whether Abraham Lincoln was justified. Now, I wonder why that is. I gave him food for thought, and he did think about it, in fairness to the man. But to come back to my subject, there are so many lies and distortions and myths which have been spread about the October Revolution, it's difficult to know where to start. But let's start with the most common one, which is repeated and repeated and repeated, you know. Of course, if as Goebbels used to say, Hitler's propaganda minister, you know, if you want to tell a lie, don't tell a small lie. So small lies are of no interest to anybody. No, find a nice big fat lie, the grossest and most palpable lie that you can find. And if you repeat it and repeat it and repeat it, people eventually will believe it. Well, yes, it's, unfortunately, there's some truth to that. And the most palpable lie and the grossest lie which you can come across is the idea that the Bolshevik Revolution was a coup. Yes, Lenin, at the head of a small band of conspirators, actually carried out a coup. You know, I actually said to Orlando Figgs during that debate, "Look, Orlando, I wish you'd give me the recipe for this, because I'll carry out a revolution in Britain tomorrow." Of course, it's just complete balderdash. It's nonsense. A child of six would not believe that. Here is a country of 150 million people. And by the way, the Bolsheviks in February only had about 8,000 members. Yes, but they built up on the basis of correct policies which corresponded to the wishes and the will of the people. You can find a striking corroboration of this allegation that I'm making in the most unlikely of places. There's a very interesting book written by Bruce Lockhart, who was a British agent, actually, in Russia at that time, who actually made this point. His book is called, you can read it, it's called Memoirs of a British Agent. He makes the point. The Bolsheviks succeed, and he predicted that they would take power, but nobody believed him. He predicted in February that the Bolsheviks would take power because they advanced the slogan of peace, because they were going to take Russia out of the war, which corresponded to what the people wanted. Lenin put forward the slogans, peace, bread, land, and linked that to the central slogan, all power to the Soviets being the democratic bodies representing the overwhelming majority of the Russian people, the workers, the soldiers, the peasants, represented in the Soviets. Peace, bread, and land, that's what the people wanted. The bourgeois provisional government had 9 months in which to carry these things out, and they didn't carry any of them out. On the contrary, they organized a new offensive which led to a catastrophe. And if Lenin and Trotsky had not taken power in October, you had the warning already in the summer with General Kornilov's attempt to take power, which would have meant the victory, as I've said previously, of Russian fascism. That was the real choice between the people. The Bolsheviks took power and did carry out what they promised. They got peace, they got land, they didn't have much bread because they were subject to immediate blockade by the hostile imperialist powers. Now look, on this question of bloodshed, well, even Figgs in his book actually says that the October Revolution, he contradicts himself actually, he says it was more like a police operation, which is more or less the truth. He said people didn't even notice it. Well, people did notice it, of course, and it was supported by the almost unanimous vote of the Soviets. But nevertheless, it is true that at least in Petrograd, the revolution was virtually peaceful. It was very, very little blood was shed in that revolution. There was an absolute ocean of blood, of course, subsequently, when the Russian Revolution was invaded by 21 armies of foreign intervention from Britain, France, Germany, Austria, Poland, Japan, the Czechs, the Czech legions, and so on and so forth, the Americans. That, of course, led to a terrible bloodbath. It's not the fault of the Bolsheviks. They fought back, of course, and they succeeded. And that's why they can't forgive them. Trotsky fought back. Oh, now they say, oh, yes, but there was bloodshed. Look, you know, my friends, war, you may not know this, war is about killing people. In a war, people get killed. You're aware of that fact, you know. And in the Civil War, yes, there was people were killed on both sides. The atrocities of the whites, by the way, have never been mentioned. Burning people alive and so on and so forth. This is common occurrence. Lenin himself was assassinated, as you may know, by an SR, a terrorist, in 1918. He was walking around the streets, no bodyguard, nothing like this, and so on. Yeah, what they cannot forgive, that's why they cover themselves with bloodshed, the same as about the French, nonsense about bloodshed in the French, or the English Revolution, if it comes to that. Why do they make such a fuss about this? There have been many wars in history. Incidentally, when we talk about bloodthirsty monsters, what about the American president, Roosevelt, not Roosevelt, I stand corrected, Truman, who ordered in 1945, ordered the bombing with atomic weapons, he used it as an experiment, on two entirely defenseless civilian centers of population in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. No military importance whatsoever. At a time, by the way, when Japan was already suing for peace, the Japanese were defeated, in effect, they were on their knees, asking for terms. By the way, those bombs were not intended for the Japanese, they were intended for the Russians. The Red Army was advancing very swiftly. So they'd smashed the Red Army, it's never mentioned, they smashed the Red Army in Manchuria, the Japanese army rather, in Manchuria, and were swiftly advancing towards Korea and Japan. They'd have taken Korea and Japan. That's why Truman dropped these bombs, quite cynically, massacring a colossal amount of men, women, and children in the most horrific manner, never mentioned. Oh, yes. Oh, that's okay, because it shortened the war. It did not shorten the war, for reasons which are given. That's a lie. It was intended as a warning to the Russians, that is all. Or Mr. Churchill, this was now apparently the greatest man in British history, according to this stupid rigged poll that they organized through television, these imbeciles in television, and shape public opinion. If you're talking about a monster, look at Churchill, who ordered the firebombing of Dresden. I don't know, 30,000 people, because men, women, and children incinerated, burnt alive, by the direct order of Mr. Winston Churchill. That's okay. That's okay. That was also perhaps to shorten the war and save the lives of our boys. Yes, but Lenin issues an order, perhaps for the shooting of a number of hostages. They did take hostages. Oh, what a monster. What bloodshed. How terrible. Come on. No, the real reason that they raise this question, and they will raise these questions now, is this. You see, think of it. Throughout the whole history of the last 10,000 years, there have been many slave revolts. The most famous of them, of course, was the one led by Spartacus, which Marx described as the greatest general of the finest figure of antiquity, Marx said, and so he was. And the Roman ruling class, when they finally crushed the slaves, as you know, they crucified thousands of them along the Appian Way as a little warning to the slaves not to rise again, because you will be crushed, because we will defeat you, because we have the power to do so. Or the Paris Commune, and people don't talk about that. I don't know how many people were slaughtered by the reactionary Versailles forces after the defeat of the Paris Commune, shot down in cold blood. Men, women, and children, no bother, no, that's okay. The Catholic Church blessed that. They even built a big church, Sacré-Cœur, dominating Montmartre, to celebrate the bloody crushing of the Paris Commune. Don't forget that. Or even the First World War itself, the countless millions that were slaughtered. Russia alone lost 3 million people. The Bolsheviks put a stop to that slaughter. Same as the German Revolution actually stopped the First World War. That's all forgotten. Never mind about that. Let's concentrate on the bloody record of Lenin and Trotsky. No. I'll tell you what. What's the reason? What's the big difference? Well, the big difference is this. In Russia, the slaves armed themselves, fought back, and won. That's the point. They won. They succeeded. They defeated 21 armies of foreign intervention. And for that, they can never be forgiven. For that, they are blamed as bloody monsters, which they emphatically were not. Not at all. Lenin and Trotsky and the other Bolshevik leaders were very humane men and very democratic men also. As far as democracy is concerned, well, the bourgeois are in no position to criticize the Bolsheviks for a lack of democracy. One party state, well, you know, Lenin and Trotsky were never in favor of a one party state. At the time of the revolution, as a matter of fact, there was only one party that was banned immediately. Only one was immediately prohibited. That was the fascist Black Hundreds, as they were called. This monstrous organization that had been responsible for bloody pogroms against the Jews. And were definitely, like the Nazis in Germany, they were immediately placed outside the law. Of course, but all the other parties were allowed, including the cadets, the Constitutional Democrats, which was a bourgeois party. Why not? They were allowed to exist. The press was allowed to be published. All the other socialist parties were allowed. The Mensheviks, the SRs, the left SRs. The left SRs were part of the government. It was a coalition of two parties. People forget that: Bolsheviks and Mensheviks. The anarchists were not repressed. This is not true. Lenin even considered at one point, Trotsky, remember, that he offered to give the anarchists part of Russia, which is big territory, to carry out their anarchist experiments if they so wished. Of course, all this was cut across from 1918 onwards, when every single one of these parties took arms against the Bolsheviks. Every single one of them. During the Civil War, where the Bolsheviks, the revolution was reduced, at one point it was reduced to just two tiny areas around Petrograd and Moscow, approximately similar, approximately equivalent to the territory of the old Muscovite territory of the 16th century. Yes, and yet the Bolsheviks were compelled to fight back. All these parties, I repeat, took arms against the revolution. They joined counter-revolutionary white governments, which were guilty of terrible atrocities. Now look, let's just work it out. America, Britain and so on, are democracies, by which we mean bourgeois democracies, which is just another way, by the way, but it's a fig leaf, actually, to describe what? The dictatorship of the banks and big business. That's what who really runs America? It's not even Trump. It's Wall Street that runs America. Everybody knows this now. And the so-called democracy is just a facade. Same in Britain. What difference does it make? Many people ask themselves this question. What difference which way I vote? Because it's the same thing. Of course it's the same thing. Because the banks and big business rule, precisely. Yes, but in the bourgeois democracy, to be fair about it, like I'm speaking to you now, I haven't yet been put in prison, not yet anyway. In a bourgeois democracy, anyone can say what they like, almost what they like, as long as the banks and the monopolies decide what happens. That's the fact of the matter. You can say what you like. I can say what I like. I'm saying it now. Yes, but what if I was to say to you, right, boys and girls, get some guns and some petrol and some bombs and let's try and assassinate the Prime Minister. Now, what do you think would happen to me, to us? You think they say, oh, that's very good, Mr. Woods, carry on, we free speech. Oh, no. I'd be in Belmarsh jail, in an anti-terrorist legislation, before you could say Theresa May. Of course. And that's the case in the most democratic state. If you take arms against the government, you're going to be repressed quite sharply, which is what occurred in Russia. Good heavens above. Did the Bolsheviks not have the right to defend themselves? Is that what you're saying? That's what they're saying. They should lay down their arms and allow these other guys to take over by armed force. Well, no. Look, that's just stupid, isn't it? No, the Bolsheviks fought because they were obliged to fight, and they won. They succeeded. They succeeded, by the way. Trotsky, of course, played a big role in creating the Red Army from nothing, which is a marvelous achievement. But the Bolsheviks fought by a combination of courage, have enormous courage in fighting against these terrible odds. The Red Army fought with guns. What are you going to fight with? With guns, artillery, and so on and so forth. Yes, that's true. But they also fought another battle with ideas. And if you press me, I consider that to be the most important thing. It was the same thing in the revolution itself. The reason why the October Revolution was virtually bloodless is because 9/10 of the battle was already won previously by political means, by propaganda, by agitation, and so by convincing with ideas the workers and particularly the soldiers. That's how it was done. And the same thing with the Civil War. You know, the British Prime Minister at that time was a Welshman, and therefore an intelligent man, if I might say so, Lloyd George. It was very, very common. Lenin paid tribute to Lloyd George. He thought he was a very smart bourgeois politician, which he was. Lloyd George ordered the British army that had been stationed in the north of Russia in Murmansk to be withdrawn. And when he was questioned on this in the House of Commons by the furious conservative opposition, why have you withdrawn our troops from Murmansk? And Lloyd George turned to them and said, gentlemen, I was obliged to do so because our soldiers had been infected with Bolshevik influenza. There was an influenza epidemic at that time. And that's a fact. Every single one of the armies mutinied. Every single one of the because they'd been influenced by the great ideas, the revolutionary ideas, the socialist ideas, the democratic ideas, the internationalist ideas of that greatest of all enterprise, which is the Russian Revolution.